It is time for another chapter from The Nature of Code.
Now, I've got a little bit of an issue here, because I'm not entirely sure whether this should be chapter 5 or chapter 6. In the first edition of the book, it was distinctly chapter 6, as you're seeing right here, burned into the screen of this video forever. But I am toying with the idea of moving this up to chapter 5. This is not the most important thing for me to cover in this video. The important thing is the topic, autonomous agents. And this is why I am so gosh darn excited about this topic. Let's say I have a table, and I were to place a block on the edge of that table. Adding a wind force expressed as a vector, this block, this inanimate object with no agency or being or life or hopes or dreams or fears, would just whoosh, blow off and fall off the table. But what if this wasn't a block? What if this was a magical creature? And instead of a gust of wind, there was a big, bad, scary monster. And remember, this is no longer an inanimate object. It's a being with desires and feelings, and it feels fear, and it decides on its own with its brain to leap off of this table to escape from the monster. Now, it might seem ridiculous that I'm going on and on about this, but this is a big conceptual leap. An inanimate object, which is all of the simulations that I've looked at in chapters 1, 2, 3, and 4, versus an animate object, an object that has its own ability to perceive its environment, make decisions, and perform actions based on those decisions, based on its perception of the environment. And this is exactly the way that I think about what it means to be an autonomous agent in the context of the examples that I'm demonstrating to you in the Nature of Code book. So let's, for a moment, zoom all the way to the end of this chapter. The last example is a flocking system, which I'm showing you behind me right now. Here, I think we can take a peek into what are the three key components of what it means to be an autonomous agent. Number one, an autonomous agent has a limited ability to perceive its environment. So it has some kind of sensors built into it. It knows where it is in relation to other things in the P5 canvas itself, because that's what we're working with. But that word limited is really critical. It's not an all-knowing creature that can see everything around it, but we're going to get more unique and lifelike behaviors if it can only see within a certain distance or what's right in front of it. Or maybe we think about its perception not as vision, but as some other type of sense-based perception. An autonomous agent processes the information from its environment and calculates an action. Again, this is the critical conceptual leap forward. Instead of being an inanimate object that's just responding to forces in the system, the object itself, the agent, is perceiving and then translating its perception into a force, into an action that it's going to take. An autonomous agent has no leader. Now, this is not necessarily a hard and fast rule in what you should always do when you're programming things in P5JS, but it is an important, critical note here in terms of this flocking example. This is an example of a complex system, a system that is more than the sum of its parts. It exhibits a kind of global intelligence, and yet that global intelligence does not come from a single leader. There's no one leading the flock around. The behavior, the emergent behavior that you're seeing, comes from all of the small local interactions between all these little triangles moving around the canvas. Each one of these, what are actually called voids, just follows three simple rules: alignment, cohesion, separation. And I'm going to get to those rules in a later video where I go through this in detail. They're easy to understand and easy to define. The outcome, the resulting system, is chaotic and hard to predict. But I'm getting ahead of myself and veering, or should I say, steering off into strange directions that I don't need to go down right now, because I want to double back and start with what is the core foundational element of what it means to be an autonomous agent, and how does that element link back to everything I've done already in chapters 1, 2, 3, and 4, and maybe 5. I'm not really sure. We can trace everything I'm talking about right now, all of these ideas, back to the book Vehicles, Experiments in Synthetic Psychology by Italian neuroscientist Valentino Breitenberg. One way of looking at this book is an exercise in science fiction. A Breitenberg vehicle is an entity, a vehicle that is a hypothetical self-operating machine that can make decisions about how to behave in an environment based on its sense perception. Take this example of these two Breitenberg vehicles. The one on the left, A,
has sensors to detect a light source and always steers away from that light source, while the one on the right, B, always steers towards that light source. But the sort of magic, the wonder of Breitensberg's book is not the sense of these vehicles as just steering away or towards, but as exhibiting emotion through their sense perception and motion itself. The left exhibits fear, moving away from the light. The right exhibits aggression, moving towards the light. Breitensberg vehicles have been a source of inspiration for many artists. Notably, one of the creators of processing itself, Casey Rees, used them as inspiration for his series Process Compendium. Here's also a sketch that simulates Breitensberg vehicles in processing itself that Casey Rees created as part of his artistic process in developing the series. I'm really saying the word processing a lot. Have you noticed that? So why am I going on and on about this book called Vehicles? Well, in addition to just being a wonderful thing on its own, it serves as a core piece of inspiration for this paper by Craig Reynolds from the 1999 Game Developers Conference, Steering Behaviors for Autonomous Characters. And in this paper, Reynolds proposes a set of solutions for autonomous characters to behave in a world in a lifelike and improvisational manner. This work is key and fundamental to so much that we experience in today's computer graphics, animation, games, films, interactive systems, all of that stuff. And ultimately, what I want to do in this chapter is outline the core principles of Reynolds' paper and re-implement those principles using P5JS and all of the stuff that I've done in chapters 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. In fact, scrolling down in the paper itself, under a simple vehicle model, we quickly find that what are the properties of that vehicle? Mass, position, velocity, max force, max speed, orientation. This is exactly everything that I've done with mover and particle, and now what I'm going to call vehicle. In the paper, Reynolds takes the idea of the motion of an autonomous character and divides it into three steps. So I'm going to go through a little bit about these three steps, but I want you to just get out your mental notepad and take a note of this first one, action selection. This is really where your own creativity can shine. What are the agents, the characters in your world, what are their goals? What are their hopes and dreams and fears? What's their strategy? What kind of plans do they have? This is really, you know, I'm going to go through some canonical examples of steering behaviors like seeking a target, fleeing a target, but you are going to have your own creative ideas of what kind of world you want to build. Steering, this is going to be the big focus of the next video. It's actually a very simple formula, and it all boils down to calculating a force. So we're really lucky we spent two whole chapters going on about vectors and forces, because it's going to boil down to a formula to calculate a steering force. And then locomotion is how does that agent, that character, how does it animate, how does it move? So in one sense, that's the physics engine you're using. And in our case, it's position, velocity, acceleration, or maybe you're using a different physics engine. But it also, you can think about like what is its design? Does it have oscillating wings? Lots of other things that you could put also your creative spin on. If you have the time, I really would recommend reading the full paper. It's pretty accessible and explains all the different kinds of concepts and actual algorithms for the different steering behaviors in a lot of detail. Ultimately, it's my goal, personal goal, to have a P5JS example for every one of these behaviors that Craig Reynolds outlines. I have a bunch of them already, and I'm going to do some of them in videos, and then maybe eventually on the Nature of Code website or in the Coding Train website, you'll be able to find additional ones. But if you want to contribute and try any of them that I haven't done already, I highly encourage you to do so. I should also note here this distinction between simple behaviors for individuals in pairs and combined behaviors in groups. So this idea of emergence of a complex system, that's really going to arrive when I get to going through combined group behaviors. Flocking being the one that I refer to as the sort of ultimate example of this chapter. But I'm going to start in a few videos just going through the sort of core foundational examples of what it means to program an implementation of Craig Reynolds' steering force. And the first one I'm going to start with is just seeking and fleeing a target. And that's what will be in the next video. I really hope that these concepts inspire you and that you discover a new set of tools or ideas that you could incorporate into your own practice, whatever that may be, and I can't wait to see what happens. So see you, there was no code in this video, I think, if I'm right, but the next videos all throughout this chapter will be heavily about the code implementation themselves. Oh, also, I already made two whole coding challenges about steering forces and the flocking system, so if you wanted to kind of leap ahead, I'll put links to those as well. You can go watch those. Those were made several years ago. But I'm kind of doubling back now to go through all this stuff in a bit more detail. All right, thanks for being here. I hope you liked this video. This was a hard one to do, and I hope that it made sense. And let me know what you thought. I'll see you soon.